Yes, we'll get started. Hello, everyone. Welcome. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on whatever part of the world you're joining from. My name is Amit Varshney, and I'll be the host for the session today. Thank you all for joining, and thank you for the support you've provided the children and the villagers that Pradivar serves. The COVID-19 situation has put an enormous amount of pressure on underprivileged communities, and the Parivar team is stepping up to the challenge. This webinar is our attempt to provide an interactive update where you can hear directly from the people in the field and get your questions answered as well. Before we proceed, just some housekeeping items. We are planning around a 45-minute session today. The discussion or the update will be for the first 20 minutes or so, and we'll keep the remaining 20 minutes for Q&A. Everyone except for the panelists is on mute for the session. So if you have to ask any questions, please type them into the Q&A box. You should see them either at the top of the window or bottom. There will be a Zoom panel, and you should be able to see a Q&A box. And please type in the questions there, and we'll be asking them on your behalf. We are also recording today's session. The recording will be available on demand after today. And we'll also be sharing, there are some slides which have some information that may be useful. So we'll also be sharing those with you after the webinar. For attendees today, you will be receiving both the link, and actually even for people who registered, they'll be receiving a link. And in fact, we'll try to share it with our entire support group. We're also trying to see if we want to open a new communications group, WhatsApp group. And so there's links due through the slides for that. So you just have to click on that and automatically join you to that group. So you'll get some updates there as well. And finally, for any other questions or comments, please write to us at donormattersus@parivar.org or directly to Lalit or me, who've been sending emails from our accounts, and we'll get back to you promptly. All of this information, site information, we'll share towards the end. So with that out of the way, just maybe a few minutes to begin with. Most of you may already know of Parivar and Vinayak, but for those of you who are just becoming familiar, let me all give you all a very brief introduction. Parivar was founded by Vinayak Lohani. Vinayak went to the Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, 2000, worked for a year, and then did his MBA from IIM Calcutta. Now, for all of you, you know the lucrative business schools or these best business schools in India, the placement season is the most coveted time. But instead of following that, Vinayak actually opted to stay out of that because he was clear he wanted to follow in Swami Vivekananda's path. And he really wanted to choose a life of humanitarian service. So he started right outside of IIM Calcutta, and he was very clear that it was to be a life of humanitarian service. So he basically noticed that he could be a guardian, like an elder brother or sister, to underprivileged children. So with three children, he started his journey of Parivar in 2003. And that has now become a residential facility with a girls' residential campus and a boys' residential campus and a high school for 2,200 children. And this is, as some of you who may have visited Parivar, this is not an orphanage of any kind. This is a family. This is the whole goal being redemption of childhood for the children. They never have to leave Parivar. It is their home. They can stay and come back and as much as they can, as much as they want. Most children, you know, as they go on to college or to go to the jobs, come back or start to volunteer as well. And then in 2017, in addition to West Bengal, Parivar started in Madhya Pradesh. And the idea over here was that Madhya Pradesh happens to be, some areas of Madhya Pradesh happen to be amongst the poorest in India, especially in terms of human development indices. So if you look at the HDIs compared to all the countries in the world, certain areas of Madhya Pradesh have HDIs much lower than most, even lower than sub-Saharan Africa. And so the villages over there are in a poverty trap. Vinayak identified a program that breaks this cycle, not only changing the lives of children and giving them a bright future, but also transforming their families and villages along the way. So there are a lot of amazing details to how these programs are run. But in the interest of time, I will move to the topic of today's session. And that is, in the light of the COVID pandemic and how there has been a lockdown and how that has impacted the villages, specifically in Madhya Pradesh, how the Parivar team has stepped up to the challenge and helped and really address the issues that are impacting these most underprivileged of families and villages. Now on to, we'll be hearing from our speakers today. Siddharth Parmar is the chief coordinator of Parivar Madhya Pradesh and has been working in Parivar since it started in Madhya Pradesh. Siddharth has a law degree from National University of Juridical Sciences, Kolkata, and a master's in sociology from Delhi School of Economics, Delhi University. He worked in the corporate sector for 1.5 years as part of the legal team of ICICI Bank, and then moved to the social sector with Parivar. And he has been there since Parivar started in Madhya Pradesh. Kapil Bharadwaj is the operations coordinator at Parivar Madhya Pradesh and has been with Parivar since 2017. Kapil joined in West Bengal and after 4 months of immersion, moved to MP as operations coordinator. Kapil has a BTech degree from Kota, Rajasthan, and worked for 4 years in IT and software development, first with Z Group and then with Oodles Technology, before moving to the social sector. So with that, I'll turn it over to Kapil and Siddharth. And you'll notice me saying Kapil and Siddharth together because in Parivar, we don't really lay a lot of emphasis on titles. It is sufficient to know that they both work very closely and run the operations for Madhya Pradesh jointly under Vinayak's guidance. So with that, over to them.
Yeah. So thank you so much, Amit sir, for talking about Parivar and how we originated and came till now. So before going into our Madhya Pradesh work, I'll just briefly touch upon the situation in West Bengal in our residential institution. So when the COVID crisis came and the government issued orders, so because of those orders, we had to send the children to their homes. So their parents and guardians came and they brought, they took them back to their homes. But some of the children who did not have parents or their parents could not come, they are staying there in the residential institution. So there are 120 such children. And our 65 Sevavratis, the staff basically, is also staying there together with Vinayak sir. So Vinayak sir is also there to monitor the situation there. So that is the situation in West Bengal. But coming to Madhya Pradesh, because we work in Madhya Pradesh and we have reached various districts and remote villages of Madhya Pradesh. So there is a lot of opportunity and a lot of need also to work and during normal times and of course during this current COVID crisis. So before going into how we are dealing with the COVID crisis and subsequent lockdown and the economic and health situation, I'll just briefly touch upon and how we are working in Madhya Pradesh, our spread and our the structure of our program. So we are working in 5 districts of Madhya Pradesh. 2 districts are Devas and Sihor, which are near the Indore and Bhopal, which are the major cities of Madhya Pradesh. There is one district towards the north, which is Shyopur, and then 2 districts towards east, that is Chindwara and Mandla. So that is our spread. We are spread in 157 villages in these 5 districts, catering to around 15,000 children in centers, which basically provide supplementary nutrition and education. So these centers run in the morning and evening shifts, and we provide education in both the shifts, around 3.5 hours of academic engagement, sports and co-curricular activities, as well as adequate and nutritious meals, both in the morning and in the evening shift. So in the morning, we provide breakfast, and in the evening, we provide dinner. Now, these areas are one of the most as...
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Amit, you're speaking on mute. It looks like Siddharth's session goes
on. Oh, yeah. Sorry. So, Siddharth, it might help to turn off video, and that might help with the connection. Same thing with you, Kapil, as well.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry. It was got disconnected. Sorry. Yeah. So what I was saying is, So we are working in 157 villages in these areas and providing supplementary nutrition and education. Now these areas are basically suffer from severe child malnourishment and very low education levels. So just to give you certain statistics, which are basically coming out from the government surveys, like the survey of National Family Health Survey and other government surveys. So Madhya Pradesh has the highest infant mortality rate in India. So infant mortality rate is basically number of children dying per 1,000 live birth, which is 47 for Madhya Pradesh, whereas the national average is 33. So while the entire India is very low on these indexes, on these HDI, Human Development Indexes, but Madhya Pradesh is among the worst. Similarly, it has the highest percentage of anemic children. And most of these statistics are bad because there is a particular section of people who are the most disadvantaged, and that is the tribals in Madhya Pradesh. So most of these villages are where we are working are selected by us based on our field surveys as well as our academic research to target this these tribal communities. So more than 90% of these persons, these children are tribals. So we are providing these facilities in centers which have been given to us by the community. The location is offered by the community, and we provide education and nutrition. Now, coming to the COVID crisis and the subsequent lockdown. So the national lockdown was imposed on around 25th and 26th March. But even before...
I'm sorry to interrupt, Siddharth, but there were some questions that we saw coming in, and I think it might also help. In the interest of time, I did not provide a full detail of how the Madhya Pradesh operations work. But maybe I'll just spend a minute explaining that. And of course, please correct me with more details because you know more. So on the Madhya Pradesh operations, just for everyone's benefit, my apologies, we thought we would have explained that earlier. So the way the operations work is, it is a supplemental education to the government system. So there are government schools, and many of you know, there is a midday meal program that government schools have. So while that is good, that starts right, there are a few challenges which hinder the education and nutrition outcomes for the children. One is, most of these children are first generation learners, which means that no one in the family has any literacy. So when they're going to these government schools, which may be a few kilometers off away from the villages, while they're going there and they sit in the classes and they eat the meal, it is not guaranteed if they have had a breakfast or a dinner. Secondly, whatever they learn in the classes, there is no way of them getting reinforced back at home, or whether they've learned it the right way or the wrong way. And so there's no guidance that they're getting, or there's no augmentation of any gaps that they may have, because they're the first times that they're going to school. What that does is, on the educational side, because of the promotion system that the schools have, which is very similar to, if you're in the US, very similar to what the No Child Left Behind used to be, that doesn't matter if their educational thresholds are met, they keep getting graduated to the next level. So there are instances where children are in the fifth grade, but all they know are the alphabets. On the other side, with the nutrition, while they have the midday meals, because of the breakfast and dinner not being guaranteed. Now, these are villages much interiors. And so there might be the village mandi, the village market, that may happen once a week. So that's where you get the vegetables, but that lasts only 1 or 2 days. Combine that with the poverty that these, and the poverty trap that the villages and the villagers are in, the families are in, it's not really guaranteed that the quality of meals will happen. So there are two things. One is hunger, the other is nutrition. While you can say that they might not be hungry, but the fact is, because all they're eating are maybe just the coarse grains or low quality staple, while they might be not hungry, the nutrition outcomes are very, very poor. And so it leads to stunted growth, poor brain development, even cases of dwarfism. And that is on the better side. There are also cases where food is not enough to begin with, right? So both of those combined really make it that the kids need that supplementing, and especially in those early stages of life where they need that nutrition to have normal and proper brain development. So the Seva Kutir program does that. So it starts with breakfast, and the breakfast is designed by nutritionists, looking at the areas that we're operating in, what are the deficiencies, and therefore it augments that with nutritious food. So that starts with breakfast. Then with a preschool education program, so classes depending on what level the children are in. Then they go to the regular public school. Over there they get their education, they have their lunch, they come back, again supplemental education to cover what they have studied, and then to fill the gaps, playtime, and then snack, and then dinner. So what that does is it provides a full course for the children for the entire day. And this is only for the children. And like I was mentioning, it's the children get the support, the nutrition and the education. And so the educational outcomes, and we're conducting a third party study on the impact of nutrition and education items of the, outcomes of the children plus on the communities. But it also changes the lives of the villages and the villagers, because now the kids have been taken care of, their nutrition and education is taken care of, plus our team works with the villagers themselves in terms of getting them to access government financing or government schemes, and therefore the pressure on them is reduced, and the outcomes in terms of coming out of poverty trap are a lot easier. So just wanted to give everyone that brief. I'm sorry, Siddharth, to interrupt, and sorry for everyone, but this is sort of the basics, and then we can get into more detailed questions in the Q&A part. I won't keep everyone from the meat of the session today, which is to get into our response to COVID. Siddharth, over to you.
So thank you, sir. I just saw that there were some other questions also coming up, but I would continue with the presentation about our MP work and the COVID relief measures. I hope some of these questions will get answered during the presentation, and if anything remains, we can discuss it in the later question and answer session. So as Amit sir was saying, that that is how our core efforts during normal times aimed at building the nutrition of these children, helping them get an adequate and balanced diet, as well as helping them in education. So there are government schools, but because of the very low quality of these schools, the children are basically not getting any meaningful education. So these centers help the children get good quality education as well as adequate meals. So that is how we are working. And our team, to talk about the structure of the organization in MP. So in each center, we have around 6 to 7 staff, which consists of teachers and cooks. And then every 5 to 7 kutirs are organized under one cluster in the nearby areas. Like 5 to 7 kutirs centers in a nearby area are organized under one cluster. And each cluster has got 2 cluster coordinators who supervise the functioning of all these kutirs in their own cluster. And by going there daily, so we have provided them bikes and they go to the kutir daily. They see that the teaching is happening well. They see that the food is cooked and is served to children. So that's how we maintain a supervision over these kutirs. And these cluster coordinators basically talk and work very closely with the district anchor, who is mainly in charge of that particular district. And above the district anchor comes the central team, where I am there, Kapil is there. We have resource persons in education. We have education coordinators who travel to these kutirs regularly, train the teachers, design the academic program and all. So that is how the structure is of our staff at the kutir level, then at the cluster level, then at the district coordinators, and then at the central level. That is the entire working structure. And so I've told you the main components, the working structure, and one minor thing about how do we set up these kutirs. So we identify poor remote tribal villages through our local staff who are living in that area for a long time. And then we talk to the community, tell them about the program. And one very interesting and unique feature of these centers is that the location, the venue is offered by the community. So we get somebody's house or a vacant government building, and then we take a survey of the children, and we basically aim at least getting 80 to 100 children, because a very lesser, like 20, 30 children would not make the center very viable. So if we get 80 to 100 children in the age group of 4 to 14 years, so it's basically starting with preschool to class 8. So that is our target segment. And after 8, we are adopting various measures, like we'll be building residential institution also along the lines of our Bengal work and all. So that is there. But in the kutirs, the age group of these children is 4 to 14 years. And then after that, we supply the materials, the grocery and stationery and other things. And then the kutir starts. So that is the entire framework of our work in Madhya Pradesh. And we have, in 2018, February, we had just 3 kutirs. And now, within a span of 2 years, we have moved to 157 kutirs, catering to around 15,000 children. So we have really scaled it up quickly. And apart from the core components of education and nutrition, we try to build a close connection with the community, which is coming like very useful during certain difficult times such as this. So I'll now go on to talk about the our COVID relief measures. So as you know, the COVID crisis and the subsequent lockdown, when it was announced, because of that, especially in also in villages, it is being enforced quite strictly, and movement is not possible. Though within the village, people may move, but outside the village, going to the market, going to a distant village, that is not possible at all, because the lockdown is being strictly enforced. So in the initial days only, we developed this strategy of coordinating very closely with the government, and because we have so many ground staff, to basically identify those people, those families which are not able to get the government support and which are in a difficult circumstance. So we have adopted a various set of relief measures, which I will talk about. Now, the first relief measure, first major relief measure that we are undertaking is relating to food, because food is the most basic necessity. So the government is basically distributing ration under the public distribution system for 3 months to all those families which have got the ration card. So firstly, we are coordinating with the panchayat officials, telling the villagers that see, this is getting distributed, go to them, take the ration. Or if somebody doesn't know, we are informing them. And or if some panchayat was a little bit lax in starting with this, then we talk to the panchayat sarpanch and the secretary. We created a pressure to implement this as quickly as possible. So that is we are doing. But in spite of the government distributing rations, there are around 8 to 10 or 10 to 12 families in each village which is not able to get these rations. The reason is that they do not have the ration card. Now, it is very, it's disturbing and a gap in the system that even though these families are poor, but they do not have the ration card. Now, why they do not have the ration card is because of two, three reasons. For instance, just to give you an example, if there is a joint family and the eldest person has got the ration card and he has three sons. Now, the sons get married and they break up and they form their own families. But the sons are not getting the ration card, or one out of those three sons got the ration card, the other two did not get. So that is one case. There are other cases where because of some discrepancies in documents or something like that, people did not get the ration card. So there are certain cases of that. So we identified those cases. We talked to the village sarpanch, told them that this is a very critical situation. And even then, when they do not have the ration card, the government should provide the ration to them. And there are also central government and state government orders that people should be provided ration even when they do not have the ration card. So the panchayats concurred with our view all, and they gave them the ration. So as of 12th April, there are 442 such families in these five districts where we are working, which have got the ration only because of our intervention. So they did not had the ration, but we intervened, and then the panchayats gave them the ration, which would basically involve wheat, rice, pulses, and salt, the only the most basic necessity. Apart from these 442 families, there were 30 families in Shivpur district, which is one of the worst district in Madhya Pradesh in terms of development indicators, and also one of the worst in entire India. So in Shivpur district, there were around 30 families, which even after, some of which had not got the ration, even after we told the panchayat, some of them had got the ration, but only for 3-4 days. So we distributed our own kutir stock, which we had got to them. And we distributed rice, wheat, pulses, salt, oil, all these necessary items to these 30 families in Shivpur. So that is one relief measure, that is the distribution of food. Again, in Bhopal city, where we do not directly operate, we do not have any centers as such. But because Bhopal is being severely hit by COVID crisis, there are more than 200 cases. And it's a big city, there are many migrant families. So we identified through our volunteers 80 families and distributed basic ration items to them. Apart from this ration distribution, the second thing, second major relief measure that we have undertaken is direct cash transfer. So because some families we have found out, especially in starting with Shivpur district, because that is one of the worst, poorest district, that some families, even though after getting some ration, did not have any cash left out with them to buy the other necessities. So we identified these families and deposited rupees 1,000 each in their accounts. So till now, this has been carried out in two districts, Shivpur and Sihor. In total, 613 families have got rupees 1,000 each from Parivar, which is, amounts to total of 6.13 lakhs. And we are undertaking surveys in the other three districts also, and we'll be depositing this cash in some of the these families, which we find out that are extremely poor. They do not have any cash left out with them. So we'll be depositing cash to their accounts as well. So that is the second relief measure. Direct cash transfer. The third thing that we are doing is helping certain migrant laborers who are from outside states but have got stuck in these districts. So there were not many cases, but at least two cases. In one was in Shivpur district, and the other was in Devas district, Dehri village. So even during the initial days of lockdown, our cluster coordinators found out that there were around 16 laborers in Karahal block of Shivpur district who were doing some electricity work. But after the lockdown was imposed, their contractor ran away. And the government was also not doing anything for them. In fact, when our team found out this case and met them, one or two persons even started crying because they did not have enough cash. They did not have food. So our team talked to the SDM, which is the sub-divisional magistrate, which is in charge of the block or tehsil, which is a subdivision of the district. So the government responded quite positively. They gave them some cash also, and some food also. And it is being done even now. The food is being given to them. And in Dehri village in Devas district also, there were 10 laborers who were working in Narmada pipeline project. And they were identified by our team and reported to the panchayat. And the panchayat has arranged for meals to them. So that is a kind of third kind of response. The fourth major thing that we are doing is regarding the health checkup of people in the villages. So now after the lockdown has been imposed, hospitals, private clinics and all those things have shut down. So we are spreading awareness about the COVID crisis and the disease, and asking them to employ all the safety measures, as well as reporting any cases of sickness to the health officials and the doctors. So till 12th April, we had collected the data, and there were around 358 such persons who had got medically checkup because our team identified them and talked to the local health officials. Apart from that, apart from ensuring their health checkups, we also talk to the panchayat and coordinate in distribution of masks and sanitizers and even spraying of disinfectants. So regarding the health response, apart from that is what we are doing. Yeah. The next, apart from all these things, the other main thing that we are doing is ensuring that the government schemes, which have been announced by the central and the state government, their benefits reach the community. So the government has announced a lot of schemes. Some of it were pre-existing in nature, and some of it were announced only after the COVID crisis came. And the government has started implementing these also. So we are firstly, we are spreading the awareness of these schemes, as well as we are keeping track of whether these are being implemented or not. So, for example, one scheme is the PM Kisan, that is the farmer scheme, under which a small farmer would get rupees 6,000 in a year.
Hello.
Kapil, looks like Siddharth's connection is again, it seems to be dropping off. Maybe you can pick up.
Yes. So the government schemes which Siddharth bhai is telling, that one scheme is Kisan Samman Nidhi, which is announced by central government, and it has 6,000 rupees per year for small farmers. So 2,000 rupees is being transferred in the accounts of beneficiaries, and one due to the like situation is that all government is, schools are closed now, so the midday meal which was prepared in schools earlier, which now it is distributed in packets to children, and it is being distributed to their home. And one more scheme is that rupees 500 is being transferred to women of a family into their Jandhan account. It is being transferred from COVID relief fund. And one more scheme is widow and elderly pension scheme, where every elderly person of a poor family will get 600 rupees. And Manrega scheme is also there, where people will get some money who is enrolled in Manrega scheme. And I would like to tell you that yesterday itself, MP government has announced that it will give 1,000 rupees to those people who are resident of MP but are stuck in different states, like who are migrant laborers in other states. So government is announcing many relief measures, and every week we are hearing some kind of relief measures by government, but it is very important for us or to all the beneficiaries that these scheme will like get implemented in place properly, and every beneficiary is aware of the scheme. So we are working closely with the government, and we are filling these gaps where beneficiary is not aware, and government is also not aware of that some people are falling in the gap. So that is what we are doing, and it is very important or very crucial to see in coming days that how this situation, how things will go after lockdown reduced, because now people are sitting at home and they are like having essential food items, but after this lockdown end, people will see look for work, and now then we will only see the impact of COVID-19. So I think that's all we have to update on this COVID situation.
Hi, thank you, Kapil. I would like to add a few points just to sum up the discussion. Hello? Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So overall, if you see the situation is like that, and the lockdown is being enforced strictly, and because of that, definitely it is causing problem, and also because of the existing poverty of these people the situation is quite worse. Just to give you an instance, for example, during our COVID survey and these relief measures, we found out that in Shivpur district, some families in each village have even mortgaged their ration cards as collaterals to the money lenders. So basically, they took some loan for some purpose and they did not have anything to give for mortgage or to repay the loan. So they mortgaged their ration cards. And basically, those money lenders are getting the ration and not these poor people. So that is the amount of the extent of poverty in these areas. Even, you know, like there are other problems. For example, in this elderly pension scheme, though all the scheme says that all the senior citizens, elderly persons should get the pension. But in our surveys, we found out that around 30% of these elderly women and men did not get the pension because sometimes what happens, there is some discrepancy in the document. And generally, the local government authorities most of the time are not very, you know, very conscious of this, of these problems, or very sympathetic towards the these tribal villagers. So because of the some discrepancy or non-availability of some essential documents, they did not get the pension. Or in some cases, they just reported to us that some months back or some years back, the pension just got stopped. And when they inquired, and they did not get any response, and they're just not getting the pension. So that is, again, the gap in these schemes, that even though a major section of population is getting it,
right. But yeah. Sorry, Siddharth, you were saying. Like the connection again.
There are again a significant number of persons. Hello.
Yes, go ahead. The connection was spotty for some time. Now it's back.
Yeah. So that is the overall situation, that the existing poverty and the existing bad condition of these villagers has been, you know, like has increased their vulnerability during these times. And we are trying our best to at least coordinate and inform the government and to ensure that they get these benefits. And wherever we find that the government's efforts are lacking, we at least inform the government, pressurize the local officials, or we do something on our own. For example, as I said, distribution of stocks or giving the cash and all. So that is that is what I wanted to say. Yeah.
Perfect. Well, thank you. First of all, thank you so much, both of you, for, of course, telling us all over here. You know, the information about what's happening on the ground as it is hard to come by, and especially when you're across the world, on the other part of the earth, it is even more for difficulty getting that actual picture. So first of all, thank you for sharing that. Secondly, of course, thank you, and thank you to the entire Parivar team and Vinayak's leadership for really stepping in. I know, for example, that like you were mentioning, right, where these schemes have not worked, or people have fallen through the cracks, the team has not thought a second time before providing funds or money from our own funds. And so the question is not where they're coming from, but the question, the answer is that the beneficiaries, the villagers, they get access to the money and the food to be able to go through these tough times. So thank you for you and to you and the entire team for doing that. I just had a couple of questions just to further provide more details. So a couple of things that you mentioned, right? The ration card being put across as collateral and then borrowing money. Can you just complete that entire story? So how did the Parivar team intervene, and how did they take care of these situations?
Yeah. So we found out this in Shivpur when we were asking each and every family whether they are getting the ration and or not. So we found out that these families told us that they had the ration card, but they have given it to the money lender, and that's why they are not getting the ration. So first thing that we did, that we informed the local panchayat about this. So the panchayat, even like without the availability of ration card, they gave them
just for everyone's benefit, just
ration.
Appreciate the connection problem we are having is because Siddharth is the interiors right now in Madhya Pradesh, and therefore the internet connectivity and the cell phone connectivity is not the best. So please bear with the connection problems, but that's also happening.
Rations, but not the.
Switch off the video so that network will be improved.
Sorry,
is it better now?
Yes, please.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So first thing that we did is that we tried to get the ration from the panchayat itself, even when they did not have the ration card. Second thing is what we did was if the ration given by the panchayat was inadequate or totally not existent, then we gave them ration from our kutir also. So there were 30 such families to whom we gave the ration. And then some of these families to whom we have given the cash belongs to this category of people. So that is the 2-3 ways through which we tried to address it. We also informed the local the officials, but sadly the local officials already knew about these things, and they did not show a very good enthusiasm to proactively deal with the issue of any order from the top. And I was just found in Express, and I just found out that this situation is there in other states as well. There is a case of West Bengal in Purulia district. There was this similar situation where the top authorities then directed the families themselves to file the FIR. Now the families also, because they have to take the loans and all, so this many a times they do not come forward and complain about this. So it's a tricky situation, and the like permanent solution might be difficult. But just to address the situation at present, we are trying to ensure that they get the food somehow, either through the panchayat or through by us. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So I'm just looking at the time now. We have 10 more minutes. We've overshot the time a little bit, but since we blocked an hour, we still have 10 more minutes. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask them in the Q&A box. And we'll get Kapil and Siddharth to answer or provide any answers from our side. While you're doing that, I just wanted to also introduce everyone. This is the first webinar I think we've done from the Parivar side, and this is actually part of an effort we're making, especially in the US, to really provide a lot more engagement, a lot more information and updates about what is happening on the ground, COVID or not, right? So while COVID situation made the situation much more extreme, and so there's a lot more work and a lot more information that is needed, so we're providing that. But once the situation stabilizes, our plan is to continue the engagement and provide more and more updates to all of you who support Parivar. So we've done is we're starting to bring a little bit more structure. So Friends of Parivar is a 501c3 public charity that exists solely to support the mission and the work of Parivar in India. The board on that is Vinayak himself, along with Lalit and me, and we help with some of the administrative tasks of running that. And we're supported by some core volunteers who really stepped up and really are making a lot of things happen. We definitely need a lot more. There's definitely, as you can see, there's a lot of work being done, great work being done, but there's of course a lot more that could be done with a lot more support. And this is not just for now, but I think as we were seeing that we started with three Seva Kuteers 3 years ago. Till around end of March, we had 157, almost getting into one village at the rate of one per week. And the reason for that is because this program, the way Vinayak and the team have designed it, has a high level of what's called in the for-profit sector scalability. So it can definitely be something that has become a template now. There's standard ways of going into the village, having a discussion with the community, talking to the right people with the panchayat and the volunteers, getting that set up, getting the coordinators at the village level as well as the cluster level, running it smoothly, and then going on to the next village. So all of that is happening, and so that requires, as we go into more villages, because there's so many more that need that help, a lot of support from the supporter base, from other people that you may know of, will really help and take it to the next level. So there's multiple ways you can get involved. Of course, the monetary contribution part is definitely there. We've made it a lot easier for you to be able to do that. There's now ability for you to contribute online with a credit card or a debit card. There's you can make a direct bank transfer as well, or wiring in. All of these details are in a document or in a location, and we'll share with everyone after the call. So it's easier for you to contribute and strengthen the hands of Kapil, Siddharth, and the 800 volunteers that are working on it. On the other side, there is also the opportunity to volunteer. There's one is, of course, just engage, right? Just make sure that you're getting the updates. So we are sending email newsletters out, and if it so happens that maybe they're not going to the right email, or you've changed your email address, please let us know. We've got contact information, and send it over to us, and we'll make sure we update your records and send it out. We're also trying this whole WhatsApp new WhatsApp communication channel. All you need to do is click on this link over here, and you'll be joined to the Parivar communication channel, and that'll give us the ability to give you much more almost real-time updates as well. We'll try not to bombard you or overwhelm you with too many updates, but this is when you know all of us are on the phones. Hopefully, it'll help get those updates. Next time you are planning a trip to India, of course, after the whole possibility becomes real after the COVID crisis, do plan to go and visit and stay with Parivar, either in Bengal or in Madhya Pradesh. And I can guarantee you this, that 1 or 2 days that you spend at the locations will probably be the most rejuvenating and joyful time you would have spent. There is so much joy, there's so much positive energy when you visit either of those locations. And you probably meet Kapil or Siddharth, who will help coordinate that entire trip of yours.
Yes, sir, we will be there.
And then there's other ways as well that I've listed out. So I believe there are some questions, and we can quickly go over to them. Maybe I'll start with, how is Parivar effort looked upon by the locals? Are there any obstructions?
Yeah. So I would answer that. So basically in Madhya Pradesh, it has been like fortunately very smooth because of two, three reasons. First is that MP is overall, politically quite, what you can say, less active as compared to Uttar Pradesh or Bihar, that there's a lot in this work. That has been easy. The second reason for not finding any such major difficulty is that most of these villages where we work are kind of homogeneous tribal villages, where at least all or a very significant majority is tribals, and all people have the similar economic condition. So it's not like there are 5 to 6, 7 to 8 castes in a village, and they are like, you know, have ints and actions opposite to each other, which is normally the case in many villages in India. So that, because of that reason, even the village, they have themselves helped these centers and work. So politically, we haven't faced any major difficulty.
Okay, just for the benefit of everyone, I'll just summarize very quickly. The couple of things compared to other states.
Hello.
Yes, sorry, Siddharth, there was a connection, so I'm just summarizing for everyone. So one is that the political activism, in a way, in terms of the intensity of political activity between competing parties, is not as intense as other states. So West Bengal actually happens to be very, very intense, maybe even physically violent, is one way to describe it. But not so much in Madhya Pradesh. And so that has been at least a good thing, that at least political obstruction has not been there. On the other side, a lot of times at the local village level, the hurdles come between the village themselves because of different groups within the village who are at cross purposes with each other. Thankfully, in the areas that we're working in, they are very homogeneous in terms of their caste and class
composition. Yeah, just to add that, that is not there in Madhya Pradesh.
Correct.
Hello.
Yeah. That's right. So that is not an issue. So overall, it has been a very easy, and it's been easy, or should I say, it's not been a difficulty working with the local villages. So then I think there's one question coming from multiple people about donations that have been sent through Arpan Foundation in the past. So first of all, absolutely, if you're sending through Arpan Foundation, you can continue doing that. We are so grateful to Arpan Foundation, Parag Bhai, Arun Bhai, who've been running Arpan Foundation. And you know, we get the donations very, very promptly from them. So if you have that set up, and if that's already happening, please continue doing that. However, if you know, you're sending it directly or the first time and you want to set it up, we also wanted to let you know that it is very easy to do it directly to Friends of Parivar, which is directly tied to Parivar Education Society India as well. All of the donations go to Parivar India, either through Arpan or through Friends of Parivar. They go to Parivar India. And so there's nothing to worry about over there. There is no, we have zero expenses in terms of, it's an entirely volunteer run program. So there's no administrative expenses or any expenses otherwise that would reduce your donations or contributions to India. So all of that is there. I guess then another question was, do the donations need some kind of specification to purpose it for MP or Bengal Parivar? So at this time, I think at the current stage that we are in, if you have certain intention that you really want to send your contribution only for a particular purpose, definitely mark that out and let us know. And we will tag that along when we send this the funds over. However, I think just sending it to Parivar is good enough. We are basically proportioning it appropriately. At this time, a lot of the funds are going in, of course, maintaining the Parivar Bengal facility with the 120 odd children who are there, along with the Sevavratis who are helping and manage that. But a major chunk also is going into the operations in Madhya Pradesh. Also, what is happening is, you know, there's partnerships in a way with other nonprofits who are doing the worthy work. So it's not so much a formal partnership per se, but where it is felt that there are reaches by other nonprofits, other development organizations that are doing the work that we have not been able to reach, or we feel we don't have the expertise in. Parivar just helps them out by either advice or with funds from our own funds themselves, and just make sure the end goal is that the relief should reach the end beneficiary, whether it is through us or through some other organization that just happened. So in terms of purposes, if you're sending it to Parivar, I think I can very confidently tell you that it is reaching, first of all, Parivar India, and from Parivar India, it is reaching the needy as the intention was. Any other questions? I guess I think we're actually 4 minutes over time, but thank you all so much for participating, for all your questions. Oh, is there one last question? One more question? I can't see any more questions. Siddharth, you say there, or Kapil, you see there's a question. Can you go?
Yes, there was a question by Pushparaj Nadar that any special fund raise plan for the this special COVID effort.
Right. Yeah. So that's what I was referring to. Right now, we're not running anything specially just for COVID. But of course, any contributions you make at this time will, you know, go directly. Right now, the majority of our activities are in COVID relief, or the Parivar team's activities are in COVID relief. So whatever you contribute at this time will, of course, go primarily towards that work, because that's where the majority of the need is right now. All right, so I think with that, thank you again. Thank you all so much for attending. And thank you again, Kapil and Siddharth, for providing all these updates, and of course, for the great work you and your team are doing. We will be following up with an email with the recording of the webinar, along with all the slides and the information there. If there's any questions, anything you want to get in touch with, here are the emails. We look forward to hearing from all of you. Thank you.